Beach town kind of night here in Los Angeles, isn't it? But nobody's here to see me. We're instead going to have a great conversation with the Emmy-winning cast of Mayor of Easttown. So let's have a nice meeting with us. Evan Peters, a very warm jeans for Julian.
Last few frames of episode 5, I was feeling emotional, and now I can see all of you and I can see the wonderful audience, and oh god, I feel so emotional.
Well, Kate, it could be worse. You could be here and freezing. So let me instead ask you about, let's talk about this episode for a moment, because it's a real turning point for her. I mean, what would you feel when you saw the script for this particular episode? I'm curious.
Well, first of all, I mean, I have to say that my reaction to Zabel getting shot on the written page was exactly the same as I think it is for every audience member, that you just can't believe it. And also, I hadn't been sent episode 6 at that point. So my desire, like every audience member, he can't be dead, he can't really be dead, that can't really be it, he's got to come in. Surely it's going to cut to him on life support in a hospital somewhere. I had to wait another 2.5 weeks. They were like, oh yeah, we'll get you episode 6. Brad's just doing a few tweets. I was like, I couldn't believe it. So, I mean, I just love the fact that this middle-aged woman just goes in there and shoots the shit out of that. So for me, I just felt, in terms of, like, you know, female badassery, it just didn't get better. I'd never read anything like it in a script in my life before, and I just couldn't believe that it was going to be me that got to do those scenes. And I was very overwhelmed, but I was very overwhelmed after reading every single episode as each one would go by. In particular 5, and of course 7 as well.
Evan, let me ask you, because this is the first time you play a normal human being.
It's kind of a stretch.
and you convinced us, so I want to thank you for that. But I mean, for me, as someone who follows you, that gave me a particular rooting interest for you, because, wow, he's playing somebody who, like, has a normal jacket and wants to make contact with people.
This is jacket in episode 3. Really thought I had a healthy jacket.
Yes, I know.
Yeah, it was fun. It was great. Honestly, I was very excited to play somebody a little closer to I think I'm a little more normal. It was fun. And Craig was awesome to be able to play around with and collaborate and try different jokes and fumbling and, you know, dropping pasta on myself and things like that. So, it was fun to be able to play somebody more normal and relaxed.
But that scene, the fact this scene you guys have in the diner where you're both hitting on her and letting her know you know what's going on, is a really complex piece of machinery. I mean, there's a lot going on in that for both of you. And I want you to talk about that scene, the both of you, a little bit, because it's a pretty amazing thing to watch.
I couldn't hear that completely clearly. Can you repeat
the scene where the two of you guys are in the diner and he's sort of coming on to you, but also letting you know that he knows what's going on. It's a really complicated scene and one of my favorite scenes in the entire show. And I want you guys to talk about playing that a little bit, because you think you got his number, Kate, and you really don't. And you think you've got her number, Evan, and you really don't. And it's an amazing thing to watch.
Oh, well, I mean, whenever anyone says that what we did was amazing, I just, I just, I just feel so proud to have been part of all of this with everyone, with our incredible cast. And I have to say, like, just reflecting on our younger cast, those actors were extraordinary. They were terrified, they were so nervous, but the attitude, the incredible work ethic that everyone came to this job with really stood us in such remarkable stead. Everyone just dug in and did the work. There were no egos, there was no fuss, no sort of, I don't know, hoping that someone else was going to do their job for them. Everyone was on their A game from the word go. And that scene with Evan and I in the diner, I mean, it is a complicated scene, but it's so funny because my memory of shooting it was that we had to do it really quickly, didn't we, or something? Like we had a bunch of other things to shoot and we were behind that day. And it's so funny when I look back on it, because my memory is, oh my God, did we even get that scene? Like, I'm sure we were both terrible in our acting in that scene. There was just no time or something.
I can't even remember which scene you're talking about. It's the one in the diner.
Are you talking about his drunk scene?
No, which scene are you talking about?
The scene you saw in this episode where
we're interviewing.
And you're talking about eating clams, and isn't that disgusting? And is the food
just
the
date night?
We had to shoot that really fast, and we were both really bad in that scene. That's my memory.
Yes, it was very late. It was kind of like, are we going to shoot it? Are we not going to shoot it? And that scene had changed multiple times. Originally, it was at a wedding. Right, and then I was going to be singing karaoke and doing all sorts of crazy stuff, and then COVID happened, so that got the kibosh, and then it was in a restaurant, and it was a very awkward dinner date and a very awkward scene. It was, it was very weird. I dropped the pasta on my pants, I asked for a bite, but Craig was amazing. I loved working with Craig Zobel more than anything, and he was just so collaborative and fun and would let me improvise and play around, and thank you to you for letting me improvise and mess around and be ridiculous.
Listen, you don't have to thank me for anything, Zade. You just take all the credit that comes your way, baby. You're fucking awesome. It's true.
You're fucking awesome.
Yeah, I'm sorry to break it to you guys, but it wasn't a bad scene. I'm sorry. Don't be the first to sort of break your hearts and tell you did a really good job with it. Julian, let me ask you this, because of all the characters in this, we see the most changes in Laurie, and we think we know her at the beginning. We think she's all heart. And by the end, we realize she is all heart, and her heart is broken. And I want you to talk about that, because we'll get to see that crack, actually that break in her. And in this episode, she's sitting there and her husband's packing up to leave. I mean, just talk about that incredible evolution that she does.
Well, it was a great privilege to be able to play this person who I feel like I could relate to this community. Delco, outside of Philadelphia, I'm from a town outside of Boston, so it felt, had a similar vibe to me, working class and loyal people, loving people, funny people. And so I felt really excited to play this woman who we think we know, and how we all have secrets that we're trying not to share or show all the time. And so how interesting to get to know these things are coming, but not give them away.
I mean, can I want to have you talk about the relationship with Laurie too, because the early scenes you guys have together, it feels like Laurie is Mara's oasis. You know, I mean, she's she's the only person we see her laugh with, which is really interesting. And so there's a trust there, isn't there?
Well, for me, one of the things I absolutely loved about Mare was that she's just so impossibly exactly who she is. She just makes no apology for who she is. She carries the weight of the life that she's led on her shoulders, and she's miserable about it, and she bitches and she moans about it, and she lets everyone know how she's feeling, apart from the depth of the grief that she's feeling. That's obviously something that she keeps deeply locked away. And her relationship with Laurie, to me, is one of the great female friendships I think that I'd ever come across in a piece of writing. You know, how these two women can love each other so completely without judgment. And that is, of course, something that I think in society today, people are becoming a little more judgmental of their friends and neighbors and their communities. And to come across women like this who honor the history that they share and look out for one another and really have each other's backs, to me, there was something so beautiful and powerful about that. And I think in many ways, you know, yes, we do see Mare crack at several different moments in the story, but I think she would have cracked a lot earlier in her life had it not been for Laurie. It's a truly beautiful friendship, I think, and I just got so blessed to be able to look into the oasis that is the eyes of Julianne Nicholson, the beautiful green pools of honesty. I just felt so blessed to get to do that.
I'm gonna cry. I think what's great about that is that last, one of those last scenes you have where there's kind of no dialogue between those two characters, it's really a reset because they both have to ask themselves how they're gonna go forward. I wanted to ask you guys about playing that. I mean, it's so powerful.
First of all, it was such a huge honor for me too because I've been a fan of Kate's for many years, and an aunt actually reminded me when I was halfway through filming that when I first started acting, like one of my great wishes was to work with Kate Winslet, and so it was actually an actual dream come true. And we've known each other for a long time, but not particularly well. Though we've been there for very, you know, big. She was at my wedding and many other moments, but so to be able to do this with Kate was a huge thrill, and I think we trust each other so implicitly. And Brad, I have to say, is such an incredible writer and was not precious about his writing at all. He would say almost daily, if you don't want to say that, then don't. If you can say it a better way, do. He wanted it to feel, and I didn't do that much at all. And I'm often of the mind that say less, especially in such big moments. I feel like if you can have the, you know, a version of the experience, if you can be really in what that might be, you don't have to tell people what's happening to you. And I think we all felt
that. Yeah, and actually I have to say that one of the most striking moments for me when you, to what you're saying of Brad being fine with us cutting dialogue, one of the most exceptional moments that it worked to cut dialogue was actually in that very final scene in episode 7 with Mare and Laurie. Laurie actually did have some dialogue in those moments of them crashing together and sort of falling to the floor. There were actually some words written, and Julianne just said, no, I don't think I can speak. I don't think I will. And I'm so glad that you made that choice, because what it did was it allowed the audience to choose their own emotional reaction. Sometimes dialogue and words can almost force or try and manipulate a response or an emotional reaction from an audience. And that sometimes is not the right thing to do to an audience, especially when they've been with you for 7 hours of television. Mm. You have to often be so careful not to try and either shortchange them or manipulate how they might be feeling based on their own relationship with the story. And so it was a brilliant choice that Julianne made, I felt, there to not speak. Actually, it worked so perfectly.
I hate to interject here, but I wanted to ask you, and I wanted to ask Kate, that last moment when you just collapsed into her arms, she couldn't even bear keeping you up. It so mirrored the image of you pulling your son down when he collapsed from where he hanged himself, that is just what hit me like a ton of bricks, because to me it was sort of the same tableau, kind of. It just broke my heart.
It was in my mind, Gene. It was very much in me, because that sequence of finding Kevin hanging in the attic, climbing up that ladder, cutting him down, how she describes it to the therapist. I had lived the moment so many times myself before shooting the scene with the therapist, so that it became unbelievably real. That actually, you know, I had to be careful shooting that scene with Julianne to try and keep that memory out of my mind, because that the weight of a body, the weight of a collapsed body, is so hard to describe. It's such an agonizing feeling to be supporting that weightless emotional person. And yes, I had to separate the two, but it was in me, that feeling. Yeah, it was.
I'm glad you brought that up, Jim, because the thing I was thinking about too, as you were talking about that, Kate, is I want to ask you, Julian, where that impulse came from. Because if you're saying, Kate, it's an earned moment for the audience, but it...
The drop to the floor was written.
No, but the no dialogue.
The no dialogue was... I just felt like... So many times I find a writer has a tendency to put words in an actor's mouth to tell them, to let everybody know how they're feeling. And I feel like sometimes it's more interesting if you can just act it and not tell it. As Kate said, you can be manipulating the audience in a way that they can have their own experience with how they've experienced the whole show, the relationship that they have with each of the characters. They can then have the experience for themselves and not be told where their sympathies are supposed to lie or what that person's thinking about, because we're not sharing. We're sharing like such a small fraction of what we're experiencing at any moment. It's so much more interesting to even be unsure what the character's thinking than be told straight up. And I just felt like they came together. They didn't know what was going to happen. I loved how when they come together in that scene, it's just she comes in as she always has. Do you want a tea? Yes. And then they just can't keep it together.
I mean, there's so many great moments like that where we see that people trying to hold things together and just cracking. I think about Jean, that scene where you're talking about that Mare should forgive herself because you've forgiven yourself. And you almost get it out before you break down. You can sort of see the weight of all that coming back on you. I wanted to ask you about that moment, because we feel how much she's been trying to just hold herself up and will herself through these things and watching her daughter go through all of these things.
I think Helen has so many complicated feelings about her daughter. She's been through so much tragedy. I think she's angry at her daughter for so many reasons. I think just her daughter becoming a cop like her father did makes her angry. And she knows she wasn't a perfect mother, and that makes her angry. How dare you make me feel bad about myself? Which, if any of you are parents, you know exactly what I'm talking about. I loved the dynamic between the two of them, because I think as much as she has some anger and frustrations with her daughter, I think she's jealous of her daughter, but the bottom line is that she loves her no matter what and will be there for whatever she needs, you know.
Yeah, Kay, I want to ask you, because the scene where Helen says, sort of makes light of the fact that you're talking about that relationship with a therapist, and just the expression on your face, when that exchange happens, I just wonder, I want you to talk about that a little bit, because again, there's so many conflicting emotions playing out in this all the time.
Oh, when I ask her, I suppose you talk about your therapist, about me to your therapist.
Yeah.
No, it's like she, that's that guarded part of her. I mean, she's sort of guarded the way her daughter is. I mean, you know, Mare is kind of a chip off the old block in some ways, but you know, she doesn't want to ask because she doesn't really want to know, but she knows that Mary talks about her probably all the time in the therapist's office. Mm-hmm. And so she kind of makes it like a wise-ass joke, but it really hurts. It really, really hurts because, you know, as a parent, there's things you say and do that you wish you could do differently, but you can't, and you try to forgive yourself, and, you know. But it's just, they've had so much tragedy in their lives. But again, they manage to find humor, they manage to find joy where they can. And it's like what you were saying about those kind of communities, those working class communities. It's just part of life, you know. You hurt and you cry and you go on and you laugh and you have affairs with your friend's husband and et cetera.
You know, I think something that I really appreciated just on a personal level in Brad's writing of the show and his construction of Nair having therapy, you know, I have to admit, like, I have always been very anti-therapy. I've always said, no, I don't need that. I mean, a lot like Nair, actually, you know. I don't need any of that. I like all my stuff, all my baggage. I don't need all of that. Some strange sort of disdainful attitude, stupid, really, nonsense attitude about therapy that I had always had. And one thing I really appreciated in Brad's writing is that he took therapy out of the realms of being some sort of bourgeois thing and made it, I think perhaps, I don't want to use the word accessible, but because he rooted it in Nair, and he rooted this experience in Nair, and because Nair is so intertwined with an incredibly real community, a very visceral, normal way of life, you know, these working class people, these heroes, these special friendships that this community of people all formed. You know, you don't often expect, or it's not, I suppose, common to see on film or on television, individuals with the types of background that our characters have going to therapy. And I thought that was really important as a message, really. And clearly Nair does transform through the experience of having therapy, and that's, I think it's just important for people to see that. I mean, it certainly altered my opinion of therapy. I've had some since, actually, because of Nair. Not least because of the experience of having played Meshi and that I had to have fucking therapy. But inspired by Nair's successful experience with therapy, I got fucking therapy.
Very here first, folks.
I'm good now. I'm all better now.
I hope you're going to bill HBO for your therapy. Let's ask all you a question. I'm going to start with you, Julianne. Tell me what you thought of the character when you first saw her on the page, and then Eugene, and then you. What did you think of Lori when you first saw her on the page?
I thought that she was a very loving mother and wife and friend and a pretty stand-up woman, a proud woman, a strong woman who's able to take care of her family and keep everybody going in good times and bad. One of the things that I loved about this show is that, you know, you don't actually, Lori's around a lot, I mean, regularly, but not a lot. And I think it was so interesting, and Brad knew this and Kate the whole time, that actually getting to know her more as you went along just gave you so much, I think just people invested so much more in what her experience was in the end, because they didn't see, well, I didn't see it coming when I read the scripts. Mm-hmm. Anyway, I thought she was those things.
Look, so that's what I was asking about, a first impression, because they're all, and I'm sorry, Evan, it's really different for you, but they're all different people by the end. That's why I want to hear your first impression seeing her on the page. Gene, if you could talk about reading Helen for the first time.
Yeah, well, first, kind of like Julianne, I mean, they said, you're going to play Kate Winslet's mother. It was like, okay, I'll sign. Where do I sign? I don't have to read the script.
She can hear you, just so you know.
Hi, babe. Love you.
Hi, Mom.
Miss you. No, I liked it very much. I mean, I liked the fact that she, you know, was kind of a little bit of comic relief in a story that at first I thought, wow, this is dark. This is really, really, really dark on so many levels. Beautifully written, but dark. So I liked that element of her. I mean, I love the fact that, you know, she played cards and drank with the priest or something. but also too, that complicated relationship with her daughter, which is very lifelike, and the fact that I didn't have to wear fake eyelashes and hold my stomach in, that was like my favorite part.
Same.
And I'm guessing you didn't have to wear fake eyelashes either, but I won't get into that with
yes,
you now.
I did in the trailer.
Yes, he did. Yeah,
mostly. Just to relax, you're off time. Yeah. Well, what did you think of him on the page when you
Well, Colin was interesting. He was like, he was sort of written a little bit, initially it was kind of like a hotshot detective. Like we were kind of, I don't know, I was training in billiards. I was going to be a pool shark at in that bar scene and like, you know, Kate was supposed to see me playing and be all like, ooh. And I was just like, first of all, I don't know how long it's going to take me to learn this shot. And second of all, I don't know, like, because I knew what was going to happen to him, I cared more about somebody who was trying to redeem themselves and kind of get back their pride. And I think he feels this intense imposter syndrome and hates himself and wants to be better. And Mary makes him better and pulls him out of that. And I think getting that, I feel like by the end he's gotten that. We've got Wayne Potts. He feels better. Oh, he actually solved the case, you know, doing it the right way. And then, you know, of course, then he dies suddenly and abruptly. And it's kind of, I just found it so much more tragic and awful and real. And that was very exciting to me.
You knew from the beginning that you were going to die?
Yeah, I got the first five.
Well, I texted him after I saw the scene in the bar where you come up to her and you're so drunk.
Yeah.
And I told him, and I mean that to this day, bar hands down best drunk scene I've ever seen.
I think I wrote that same email. Yeah.
Of course, then we found out that he actually was really drunk in the same time.
I think I sent you a text saying, see, told you were good.
I was really where I was like pretty well sobbing after that scene that I didn't get it. And I was going to quit acting and shadow Craig and do all sorts of crazy stuff.
Might
do that.
You're going to quit acting?
I was very upset because I was, you know, I feel like I really messed myself up in that scene. I was really like, I was, you know, he was such an imposter and trying to do this thing and wants to be great and like, and that's what I was trying to do in that scene. And I didn't get it.
He sent me a text later that day after he'd shot that scene saying, do you have an acting coach? And I was like, Dave, with some, you know, fucking dumb emoji, whatever. And he's like, no, Kate, seriously, you must either have a coach or know of a coach because I can't carry on without one. And I'm so sorry for what I did today. I know how much of a bad scene partner I was. And I was like, oh, for fuck's sake, get over it. Like, not having any of it.
It's true. Still looking for one, by the way.
I've watched many drunk scenes myself, always not very well. And I've also acted with people being drunk in scenes, also not very well ever. And this was the first and only time that I've ever done a scene with another actor where I did actually think that you were drunk as well. I kept saying to Craig, I think we have to like stop soon because he's just getting drunk. I thought you were drinking. I did. I really did.
Yeah,
it's that. So there you go. Marcus, what you guys are all talking about is really the elasticity of this as a concept, that you all able to take ownership of these characters. I mean, Julia, you're talking about finding that moment of silence. And what you're talking about here, Evan, is just really buying into who this guy was. And Gene, you're just talking about that kind of misery. I mean, because everybody in the show is one way or another suffering from guilt. It is the most Catholic show I've ever seen in my entire life. And it's all about the way this guilt is exercised. And I guess I wanted to ask you all about that, because I feel that, and you just really talked about it beautifully, Evan, about that guilt that seems to be moving everybody along and how you think your character deals with that.
Why don't you start, Gene? Well, yeah, I mean, I don't think there's anything worse than parental guilt. There's nothing worse than regret when it comes to your child and not having been the perfect parent. I don't think there's anything more painful than feeling that you might have failed your child. And, you know, like I said, she always had very complicated feelings about Mare. Mare and her father were so close. I think she was very jealous of that relationship. The husband was depressed. He was a policeman. She was unhappy in her marriage, you know, and it all, she was probably jealous of her daughter's beauty, and then she became a cop, and so she was mad at her about that. And I just, it's all those things that complications between human beings that are just hard to reconcile, you know. And anytime a family suffers through a suicide has got to be the most long-lasting, damaging event. I can't even fathom that. My late husband's little brother killed himself, and the family just, they're never the same after that, because you blame him and you blame yourself most of all, and everybody blames each other, and it's just, there's no getting over that.
Do you have any thoughts on Laurie's guilt?
I just passed that to Gene, because I was like, guilt? I didn't really think of Laurie as holding guilt. Where would you?
I was wondering about the way she felt that she wasn't really protecting her son from what her husband was doing. It really felt there. And the way she's communicating with that baby at the very end of it, she seems to be trying to expiate.
Right. I guess it is feeling like, yes, always, because you want to protect your child from any pain, any suffering. That was there, and that was obviously an extreme example of it. The baby, I didn't think was from guilt so much, but it was more just responsibility and trying to do the right thing. Is that guilt? I don't know.
I'm asking you, but I think we do feel in that community, and it's almost like the scar tissue from everything is visited in all these households, and everyone really sort of see it when he's confessing about not having cracked that case, and you can really sort of see he's trying to talk about himself almost in the third person, but we can really feel him trying to hold it together, can't we?
Yeah, I think that was the sort of big reveal of that. That was the lie that was eating away at him the whole time. I mean, since he's done it, I think he thought it was going to really pull him out of this funk that he was in and sort of take it, my relationship's over, I'm living with my mom, maybe this will make me feel better. And I think ultimately he finds that, you know, he didn't do the right thing and it was a lie. And so, yeah, he feels terrible. And that's one of the reasons why we wanted to have Colin be so drunk in that bar scene, is because we wanted to show, I don't know if that came across, but anyway, we wanted to show sort of how much it was eating away at him. I think the idea was is that when you see him, you're like, oh man, this guy's wasted. Like, why is he so, he's kind of messed up. Like, something's going on, you know? Like, why, what's up with that? And it's just like this feeling inside that I think he's trying to squash with the booze, and you know, when Mare comes along and this case comes along, he gets the opportunity to really try to redeem himself and get rid of that guilt that's ripping away at him.
And the interesting thing about this, the subject of guilt, is that Mare carries so much guilt, so much unbearable guilt, that it makes her entirely intolerable of whatever anyone else has got going on. So she's painfully aware of her mother's guilt at having been, you know, a less than good, affectionate mother. You know, she can smell it a mile off. Colin Zabel walks into the room, and he's the kid who wants to please because of some, what, demons in your past? You don't want to even fucking know about demons, pal. You know, so Mare, and everything that Mare is it is guilt, you know, to have raised the child and to have actually got things wrong with Kevin when he was younger. She you know, she even says to the therapist, she says, I had to check out. I you know, my ex-husband had a file with all the papers and the things and all these medications, and I don't even know what half of them were. I mean, she actively chose not to acknowledge the fact that her son had significant mental illness. And so Mare's guilt, she truly feels that had she handled Kevin differently when he was a younger child, that he may not have actually killed himself. So that's how extreme the level of guilt gets within our show. And it can consume you completely. I mean, I think that's a large part of the reason why I ended up doing therapy myself afterwards, because it makes you think about yourself as a parent. As Jean was saying before, you know, no matter how much you love your children and believe that you're doing the right thing all of the time, one does question as a mother. You constantly question whether you've said the right thing, doing the right thing, helping them make the right choices, encouraging them in the right ways, not too much, not too little, listening with both ears, not just one. You know, it's constant. The weight of what a mother's guilt can be is overwhelming, can be overwhelming. And I think that's why I think you're picking up on this thread of guilt so keenly, is because we all know how terrible it can be to feel that way, to feel that guilt. And Brad wrote it brilliantly.
I'm afraid we're out of time, so let's all go out in the cold and thank this incredible group.